So now we're at the most important part. So we want to understand why the Rambam paskins in the end that it's only b'di'evid. So we made a differentiation yesterday between a neder that a person does to prohibit himself personally from something, which is called nidrei isur, and a neder when a person vows to bring a korban or to give tzedakah or to do something like that. They're called Nidrei Hegdesh. The Rambam in Hilchot Nedarim, the Laws of Vows, in Perek Aleph Halacha Daled, he writes, Mitzvat Aseh Shel Torah, it's a mitzvah from the Torah, Sheikayem Adam Shvuato Nidro, the person should keep his vow or his neder, his oath or his vow, Ben Shayam Nidrei Isur, Ben Shayam Nidrei Hegdesh. Regardless of whether it's to prohibit himself personally from something, or that he has to bring some kind of korban. Shenemar mutzas v'techa tishmor v'asita kasher nadarta, v'nemar kechol ha'yotze mipi v'yase. So, we saw yesterday that the Rebbe makes a very important differentiation between the two, that each of these two psukim, the one that's more complex in which we have a machlokus between Rebbe and Rabbanan and the rest of the Chachamim, is regarding Nidrei Hekdesh. Do you go exactly by the letter of what he said, or do you just go by the content, by what he meant? The other pasuk, the pasuk that says, "V'asita kechol asher kechol ha'yotze mipi v'yaseh," that you should do everything that comes out of your mouth, says the Rebbe, that relates to Nidrei Isur, when a person prohibits himself. And what's the thinking behind it? That when you come and you prohibit yourself from something, so all we have to go on in order to understand what you wanted to prohibit were the exact words that you said. But when you come and you say, I'm going to be chayav, I'm going to be obligated to bring a certain sacrifice, so what you've done is you've taken what's already described and meticulously described by the sages about a certain sacrifice, this is what I need to do, and you said, I take this upon myself. So there, when you say, I take this upon myself, we can try to get into the content of your words because we know exactly what you need to do. We just want to know what you meant. Which sacrifice did you mean to take upon yourself? Did you mean a big sacrifice, a small sacrifice? All these things are questions that we ask about what you said. So we don't take you so literally, but we try to understand what you wanted to say. So again, the power in the neder of an isra, when a person prohibits himself, is in a sense much greater because you're creating your own version of a religion. You're creating something, you're prohibiting yourself in a certain way that only you know, that only through your words, the power of your words, do you have that ability to do it. And we talked about the fact that the Torah doesn't want you to do this, but if you're going to do it, you're going to do it according to the laws of the Torah. I mean, the Torah doesn't want you to set up a separate religion. We said that that's related to what Chazal say, that everybody, any person who builds who makes a neder, who makes a prohibition, a personal prohibition, it's as if he built a separate altar, as if he created a separate altar, which means that it's like he's poresh from the tibul. He's not going to the communal altar. He's not going to the communal idea of what it means to be a Jew, but he's creating his own idea. So now the Rebbe says it like this. So it's about on page 7. כפי שהוסברו בהרחבת דברי הרמב"ם בסוף הלכות נדרים, אמרו חכמים, כל הנודר כאילו בנה במה. Anybody who makes a prohibition, a neder, it's as if he created a personal altar. And now you'll notice that the Rambam himself differentiates between the different types of vows. This, ואם עבר ונדר מצווה להישאל הנדרו, כדי שלא יהיה מכשול לפניו. And if a person already made a vow, he should go to a chacham and have it canceled, have it nullified. Because you don't want to be separate from everybody else. You don't want to be different. You don't want to stick out. במה דברים אמורים, what are we saying this about? נדרי איסור. When a person takes on a personal prohibition. אבל נדרי הקדש, but if you took it upon yourself to bring a korban, to bring a sacrifice, or you took it upon yourself to give some other type of tzedakah, about these things, it's the opposite. Mitzvah lekayman, velo yishael alein. and a person should not try to annul them, because that's the essence of doing more. Meaning, what the Torah wants from you is not to prohibit yourself more; it wants you to do more. That's like the basic idea that you get out of this. But the point is that when you say, "I'm going to take upon myself a korban, a sacrifice that I didn't need to bring," and it's very important to know that the beginning of the parsha. The parsha, he said this we didn't read the second note, but the parsha begins with korbanot nedava, with sacrifices that a person brings from his own will, not that he's required to. In the continuation of the parsha, we begin with the sin atonements and all those things. But the beginning of the parsha is things that a person wants to bring from himself. He says, "I want to bring this korban." It's extra. It's not something that he's obligated to do. So when it comes to these things, the Torah already said how to do it. The Torah carefully tells us how to do it. Those things, when you want to add them, so that's a positive thing.
So this is on top of standard tithing or whatever
Ela midochak, unless, when should you? You shouldn't try to annul these things. When I decided that I would do something good, okay, something above and beyond what I'm required to, I shouldn't look for a way out. Unless bedocha gadon, unless it has a real difficult reason to do this. For instance, famous one.
Financial one.
Is Yiftach. It was a judge whose name was Yiftach. Yiftach HaGiladi. And he made a vow like this. That the first animal, he didn't say animal, the first thing that will come out of my home when I come back successfully from the war. Yeah. And this will, hopefully we'll have enough time to get into it once we finish tomorrow. But there's a whole question about how a person, what do you do this for? Do you do this just to we'll get into this.
You're not allowed to do this.
So we'll talk about it. That's what we read in Tehillim and Hallel. My vows, these vows that I made for God, which are not to prohibit me, but to glorify Hashem, those I shall pay. Because it gives you the explanation. Then once I make a vow that I'm going to bring a certain sacrifice, that vow sanctifies, it already consecrates the sacrifice. If I had a particular animal in mind, it already makes it. Okay? If I say this animal will go to a sacrifice, I've already turned it into something that's hekdesh. It's already sanctified. And I'm chayav b'achrayuto. If it dies, I have to bring another one instead of it, and so on. No, if I say this animal specifically, if he dies, I don't have to bring him because he's gone. Okay. ולכן קיימת בנדרי הקדש, לפי פסק הרמב"ם, בנקודת רמב"ם, גם ההלכה, ועשית כאשר נדרת, שמקיימים את הנדר כאשר מתבצעת כוונת הנדר, כקורבן להשם וצדקה, אף כאשר אין זה בדיוק כמוצא שפתיך. So, for this reason, we do, because the person is actually saying, I'm going to do what it says in the Torah anyway, so there we look at what he meant when he said this and this animal. Which animal did you mean exactly? Because we know what we need to do with it. The only question that we have is, what exactly, which animal did you mean? What was the content of your words? But when a person says a prohibition upon himself, so we take him very literally. We don't try to understand exactly what he meant inside. It's the words themselves that create the law as a word, the different... what he's prohibited from. So now the pnimius of this. What is this all? So this is all the sugya in Nigla. And the end of every sicha is usually some kind of
moral
or an explanation in pnimius. Yadua shekorban mishon kiruv. The korban, as the Sefer Abar here says, is to bring close. Korban means to bring close. The kariv. The point of every sacrifice is to bring me closer to Hashem, the Adam. קירובו של היהודי לקדוש ברוך הוא כשהוא מקרב ומקריב את כוחותיו וכישרונותיו לקדוש ברוך הוא. It's to bring my essence closer to Hashem, my talents, my abilities. וזהו ההבדל בין קורבנות לבין מצוות אחרות. This is the difference between sacrifices and other mitzvot. Why? המצוות הן איברים וגידים פרטיים. רמח מצוות עשה הן כנגד רמח איברים. ושעשה מצוות לא תעשה הן כנגד שעשה גידים. ובכל מצווה, מצווה, מלשון סבתא וחיבור, מקשרים איבר או גיד מסוים אל הקדוש ברוך הוא. Every mitzvah, as the Baal Shem Tov taught, is to connect us in a particular way to Hashem. 248 positive commandments. They connect the organs. Each mitzvah has an organ that it corresponds to it. And the 365, and you say this word, sinews, or something like that.
Sinews.
Sinews, how do you say it?
The same way.
Sinews. Okay, I give up. The 365 sinews, they relate to the blood vessels or to the sinews, the 365 prohibitive commandments, they relate to either the sinews or the blood vessels or to the neural system. V'chol mitzvah, and every mitzvah, as the Baal Shem Tov taught, is a connection. So you connect a particular organ or a particular conduit in the body to Hashem. V'ilu ma'utam shel korbanot hi she'yodim mitmaser kulo mitkarev kulo l'Hashem. But the sacrifices bring the essence. The essence like bringing all of me closer to Hashem. So that's how the sacrifice is different from other particular mitzvot. Inyan ze mudgash gam lefi hasbara shel Ramban, madu ha'mechaprim ha'korbanot. The Ramban, Nachmanides, he explains in his Perush on our Parsha, why do the sacrifices atone? Or why do they cleanse you? שיחשוב אדם בסתו כלל, כי חטא לאלוקה בגופו ונשוב, ראוי לו שישפך דמו וישרף גופו, לולי חסד עבורי שלקח ממנו תמורה, דמו של הקורבן תחת דמו, נפש תחת נפש. קורבן הוא במקום גופו ונפשו, כי על ידו מוסרו את כל גופו ונפשו להשם. The Korban is powerful because it's as if my entire being was put on the altar and not a particular part of me. Okay? It's like I need to see, says the I vicariously see as if I would have been, my life would have been taken.
That's, I thought he was just sacrificing the Nefesh of Bahamas.
What?
I thought he was just getting rid of the Nefesh of Bahamas. Well, his whole body, not everything.
Yeah, but then there's no life anyway. You're right that there's two sides here. The one side is what he said, Adam ki akriv mikem, that the whole Adam is what's brought close to Hashem. But since the body is dependent at this stage of his life on his animal soul, if the animal soul would have been taken away, the whole body would have perished.
So Christian, last week we learned that the mitzvot is our connection to the Sovev. Right, mm-hmm. The action of mitzvot. Mm-hmm. Is there any differentiation between a positive or a prohibitive mitzvah?
Can, of course, but not in the sovev.
Are they both
in the same?
To the sovev?
Can, they're the same. As far as the sovev is concerned, it doesn't matter whether you do a asay or an asay. And usually we say that the prohibitive are higher.
Right.
Why are they higher? Because they strengthen the notion that the sovev is not about you do this or that. In a prohibitive, you're not doing something, that itself becomes the commandment. That's a higher than, again, with the prescriptive mitzvot, it's like you're saying, but you have to do it this way, not that way. And this way, not that way, is already memale. That's already filling right.
Okay. So that was
because
my question.
We get that from the Torah.
So that's my question.
But in its source, they're all the same. It says that in the source, they're called 613 pathways. And only when they come down through the memale do they differentiate into to a prohibitive and prescriptive.
Mm-hmm.
And the prohibitive retain more of the sense that everything is equal, everything is the same. זאת ועוד, מהותו של הקורבן היא עניין התשובה, כפי שמובן גם מדברי הרמב"ן הנ"ל, שהתשובה היא מעל לכל המצוות. תשובה is higher than all the mitzvot. The way that Chazal say this, the korban is to do tshuva. The korban is a kapara. It's the atonement. It's a repentance, if you want. And the way that you do this is the way that you repent is by bringing a sacrifice. So there's something about tshuva that's higher than all the other commandments. How do we see this? The Chazal say, the sages say that tshuva was created before the world. Not only that, they say that Adamim kom tshuvato nivra, that man, Adam, was created from the place where he would later bring the sacrifice. Where was he created? On Mount Moriah. That was the place that he was created. He was created in the place of the altar, where the altar eventually was. This is one of the reasons why the altar has to be in a specific place. It can't be somewhere else. It's designating the place from where a person was created. Now, whether physically he was created from there or not, I don't know. But what Chazal are trying to tell us is that the basis of all life is tshuva. You can't have creation without there being tshuva.
So Adam wasn't...
Because before there was tshuva, before, if there was no tshuva before antedating creation, creation would not be sustainable because everything sins.
Right.
You could say that when Hashem was creating worlds and they didn't find favor in his eyes, it's basically they destroyed themselves because there was no possibility of tshuva yet. And even in our world, it took time until tshuva really caught on.
The mabul.
It really caught on after the mabul. Meaning, before then, there was tshuva, but it was much, much harder to do it. And after the flood, it became much easier for a person to do tshuva. I mean, we became more, malleable.
Malleable.
Okay. The human nature in general, became more malleable, more prone to be able to change.
So by this account, Adam HaRishon was created in Gan Eden, and Gan Eden is in Yerushalayim?
Yeah, of course. What's the question? All of Eretz Yisrael was part of Gan Eden. Again, it's a medrash, so I don't know to tell you if somebody photographed it.
Right.
This is what it looks like. But the idea is there.
So Gan Eden, Israel is in Gan Eden.
Good. Theoretically, this is Gan Eden.
Well.
ויש לומר שזהו אחד הטעמים לכך שפרשת הקורבנות פותח בקורבנות הבאים בגדר נדבה, כפי שאומר רש"י מיד בתחילת הפרשה, בקורבנות נדבה דיבר העניין, ואך לאחר מכן ממשיכה התורה בקורבן חטאת ואשם קורבנות חובה. So it says this is one of the reasons for which the Parshas Vayikra starts with voluntary sacrifices, meaning that a person takes it upon himself to bring them, like in a neder or a nedava. Why? כי על ידי הקורבנות מתקרב יהודי כולו להשם, בעניין זה אינו מתבטא כל כך בקורבנות חובה. Because the voluntary sacrifice is greater than the one that you're obligated to bring, because it touches more upon your whole being than does the obligation. The obligation would be a particular, relative to a particular organ, corresponding to a particular organ in the body. But something that you do of yourself, you're doing it from your whole being. This is a very important thing that people don't understand. Why is it that when you volunteer, you feel much better than when you go to work? It's one of the basic ideas in the Western world that is sort of not discussed enough. What people just say, well, volunteering makes you feel good or something like that. But really, the whole idea behind volunteering when you're not obligated is not just because it's from your own will, but because your will, or what comes from your will, from your volition, I guess voluntary comes from volition in some way, I don't know exactly how, but it comes from your own will, it is touching upon your entire essence. Whereas when you're obligated to do something, what he's saying here is that it touches upon a particular part of your being. Obligations can only capture a particular aspect of who you are. Whereas when you do something of your own volition, by the way, what that means is that if you have an obligation and you turn it into something that you want, you also can bring your entire being into it. But you have to do that. You have to do, okay, I'm obligated, I don't know, to drive my kid to school. Okay. So if I go to it and I'm like, oh, I'm obligated, so just a small part of me is interested in this, and nothing really happens. But if I decide that even though I'm obligated, I want to do this, my volition takes over, it becomes voluntary, even though I'm obligated. That's one of the great things that a person can do to invest themselves much more into life, is to decide that even though I'm obligated for these things, I want to do them of my own volition also. And not to be, I used to call this in, I told you this once, that in cycling, I used to call it staying on top of your gear, which is that you don't you don't let the hardship run you. Rather, you run the hardship. It's like you stay on top of it completely. And you decide that this is what you want. And stay on top of a year is like, if you cycle, you understand this. It's like that you have enough power in your legs to push that gear, even though it's a hard gear, and you don't go down a gear because it's easier. But rather, with your volition, you can keep pushing it and not let it push against you. Okay. Kavanata nodel. What?
Small problem, sorry. So, bringing a korban for the sake of teshuva, that's rectification. Bringing a korban for the sake of from your own volition, that's getting closer.
They all bring you closer. But
one
what he's saying is the.
But it doesn't really bring you closer. It normalizes.
Okay.
The relationship.
Okay.
What you're saying is, if you convert the desire into the teshuva, then you could have both.
100%.
Okay.
Tet. So now, let's get back to the original question. If I say I'll bring a small korban and I brought a big one, why am I yotze only b'dieved? Kasher yudi noder l'avi korban, hara en kavanato l'kayem mitzvah pratit mesoyemet, mutza sfatecha tishmor v'chadome, ela ki d'el'el, b'chavanato l'kayem et ha'inyan ha'kli, shal hakravat atzmo et masrutah ha'mukhletet l'kadosh baruch. So it says, since we're talking here about a voluntary korban, this is a neder ekdesh, and we just explained that the whole point is to bring my whole essence closer to Hashem, myself, my very self, my nefesh. Kedivrei Chazal legabei amila nefesh hamufiyah b'korban mincha shel nedava. Amar Kadosh Baruch Hu midarko leavi mincha ani ma'aleh ani alav kilu ikriv nafsho lefanai. He says, who is the person who brings only a flower offering? A poor person. And that's all he can bring. Yet, because he brought it voluntarily, because it's an adava, it's nitvat mincha, it's as if, Chazal Ma'amim say this explicitly, I see it as if he gave his whole essence to me, okay? Even though it's only a flower offering. So know that it doesn't matter whether it's a lot or a little, the moment that you give what you, voluntarily, and again, this is another thing about volunteerism, that it doesn't matter how much you do. If this is what you can do at this moment, this is what you have, this is the time that you have, then when you give it, it's as if you're giving your entire self.
That's why Hashem says that the karbonas from the poor, as it were, the sweet karbonas. That's why he accepted their baskets and not the wealthy people's baskets.
So the wealthy can also do the same thing if he gives mamish from his essence. But it's much harder.
But he accepted their baskets, their woven baskets, but he wouldn't accept their metal gold baskets.
Ve'esh lomar shosafa ma'aleh ani alav. Why did Chazal use the language, it's as if? But they don't say it's as if. They say ma'aleh ani alav. Ma'aleh ani alav literally means, I bring him up. Ma'aleh ani alav. It's like I'm saying about him, I'm bringing him up. It's hard to translate this idiom into English.
I'm raising him
in some way, elevating him in some way. It's like saying that there's the simple meaning of the words, and then there's the more elaborate meaning, the more poetic meaning of the words. So ma'aleh ani alav is like to say we're coming out of the colloquial meaning of the words up to a more embellished understanding of what they mean. But he's saying it about the word, not about the words, but about the person who's bringing it. So the Rebbe says, "Shesh lo bechach gam netinat koach milamala, inyan shel ikriv nafsho ne'asa b'darga gvoa yoter mikfi shebechotol la'agia b'kochotav v'avodato shelo, v'megia l'darga shekadosh baruch hu ma'aleh alav." So what he's saying is that when you do something voluntarily, like the Yani here, then Hashem is giving you extra strength that you don't have from yourself. Meaning you did what you could do, which is bring a flower offering. But Hashem is taking it as if you gave your whole essence, and because you did that, He gives you more strength to do more. ולכן בקיום מצווה מסוימת זו הוא נכלל במצווה הכללית, צוותא בחיבור כללי של היהודי אל הקדוש ברוך הוא על נדבת והקרבת הקורבנות, ולכן חשוב כאן בעיקר העניין הכללי, התמסרותו המוחלטת של היהודי והתקרבותו להשם לגמרי. So this small act that he does, it transports him from just this one small act into the realm of the general, meaning again that he's giving his whole self, and his whole self is elevated. לפי זה יש לבאר תמידים קטן וגדול ברוחניות. So now getting back to he said, I'll bring a small korban, and he brought a big one. And if we explain small, this we haven't done yet, small and large in spiritual terms, בתחילת עבודתו הרוחנית שרואה יהודי במצב של קטנות, that when a person starts, before he brings the korban itself, or when a person starts to serve Hashem, he's in a state of smallness, a small-mindedness, katnut. אך כיוון שמדובר בעניין הקורבנות בקירוב כל נפשו לאלוקות והקרבת עצמו, הרי זהו קירוב וקורבן גדול, בדומה למבואר, אותו הקשר שבין יראת התא לבין יראה אילה. But since he's now voluntarily, he's not just going to do a small act, he's going to bring his whole self, he's going to bring his whole essence. And again, he does this just by doing it voluntarily, just the fact that I'm doing it of my own volition transports or transforms the act into one that is a general act. The moment, like we said about driving, that I can do it as an obligation, that is just what I need to do right now, or my whole essence can be in it. Why? Because I'm doing this because I want to do it. It's turning the obligation into something voluntary. So when you do that, you yourself transform from small-mindedness into great-mindedness. Meaning this is a way to live. Don't see things as obligations, but turn them into voluntary things that you do. Meaning even if, again, it's not voluntary that now I deserve a pat on my back. It's voluntary in the sense of volition, that don't do it because you're obligated. You have to wash the dishes at home. So the dishes have to be washed. It's an obligation. We have to do it. But if you turn it into something that's voluntary again, not that I deserve a pat on my back, but because it's voluntary because I want to do it. I turn it into something that I want. That transports and it transforms the whole act into something completely different. And you enter great-mindedness. The whole conscious state changes. And it's like a person who goes from Kabbalah's Ol, which is the lower form of doing things, to Ira'ila, which is not Kabbalah's Ol. It's not the same thing. Kabbalah's Ol is not that high. It's not the highest form. The highest form is what we call Ira'ila. What does Ira'ila mean? The higher form of fear of God, of awe of God. It's that I don't do it because I'm burdened by it. Kabbalah's Ol in the end means that I'm burdened. Ira'ila is that I perceive and I understand the greatness and awesomeness of Hashem, so I voluntarily do it. But it's still called Kabbalah Soul. Why? It's a form of Kabbalah Soul, but it's a different type of taking on a yoke, because I'm taking it on voluntarily. There's the lower form of Kabbalah Soul is that I have to do it, I'm obligated. The higher form of Kabbalah Soul is that I want to do it this way. Meaning I understand how important it is to nullify myself before the Ein Sof, before the infinite. It's like a person understands that my small wants in my life, the little things that I'm doing because I understand them, I perceive them, I don't need Torah for them, they're very small. But what the Torah tells me, what Hashem revealed to me through the Torah, that's the infinite. And if I perceive how great the infinite is, of course I want to place myself under the yoke of the infinite. So it's done voluntarily. ולכן והביא גדול. So he started out small and he ended up big. זה מביא לידי הקרבה וקרוב באופן של גדלות, שגם בגילוי ובכל כוחות נפשו מתקרב לגמרי לאשם. So even the small act becomes an act of great-mindedness. ולידי עיסוק בתורת הקורבנות, הרי כאילו יקריב קורבן, ותלמידי חכמים עסוקים בריחות עבודה, מעלה עליהם הכתוב כאילו נבנה מקדש בימיהם, ומכך כאילו נגרם לנבנה המקדש בפועל בביאת משיח צדקנו, ושם יקריב קורבן בפועל, ויותר מכך, נקריב לפניך במצוות רצונך, ובבית המקדש השישי במבנה במהרה בימינו ממש. So what he says is that when you transfer into this great-mindedness, what you're actually doing is if you actually brought a sacrifice. As if the Mikdash exists. And because you do it this way, that's one of the reasons why Hashem will build the Mikdash, will build the temple. But the idea here is to switch from small-mindedness to great-mindedness. And that's done by not doing it as an obligation, but doing it as a nedava, as voluntary. Okay, so tomorrow, what I want to talk about is whether you're allowed to make a neder or not. And we'll see that that it's not so. Everybody says you don't make a neder.
Tomorrow you will tell us bli neder.
Bli neder.
So I won't tell you bli neder. I'll tell you with a nether.
Or bli neder, you'll tell us.